Things that are bad happen in your lives. It may not be so trivial to some, but you got an F from one of your major requirements. Or you went for an interview and you failed, and the company that you dreamt all your life to work for did not hire you. You're working so hard on your marriage. You're trying to make it work because of your children and because of what the Bible says. But your husband or your wife, it's just almost impossible to get along. I heard Kobe Bryant just got divorced. Did you guys know that? Because I saw his wife at Sprinkles in Newport Beach. You know, if I meet someone who's famous, I always walk up to him and ask him and verify. Because my wife always denies that's who they are. So I just, why aren't you? She got uncomfortable, so she quickly left with her two children after I began noticing. But nonetheless, we just heard they filed for divorce. Marriage is not easy, and even the most famous of us have issues sometimes. Well, when things difficult for you to handle happen, people respond differently. I know that there are people who have just been diagnosed with cancer and they just stop coming to church. They run into a problem with somebody at church and they give up serving. Instead of trusting in the Lord, depending and gathering strength from Him, and continuing to remain faithful, every tiny roadblock along the way sometimes discourage us when we are not deeply rooted, and from the very foundation it shakes us. As I have led the church for past 14 years, I cannot say I enjoyed every problem that we had, but each problem that we went through, I think we gathered strength. And I believe anyone who has no problems in their lives are missing out on great blessing from God. Because it's when things are the darkest, steepest, and the deepest, that's when you gather strength to trust in the Lord, not on yourself. If those things discourage us from trusting in God and actually make us to walk away from God, it only reveals what we were made of all along. Why do I bring this introduction in such way? Because here in the Bible today is the passing on of the leadership from 120 years old leader called Moses. If you have followed me for the first five books of the Bible, starting from Genesis to the Deuteronomy, first five books, which we call Pentateuch, Moses wrote how God created the world, how Adam and Eve fell, how Noah's Ark happened, how Abraham was called, and how at the time of Joseph, the nation of Israel, 70 of them went down to Egypt. After 400 years, they grew to 2 million, and finally God used Moses to lead them out to the promised Canaan land that God promised their forefather Abraham. But along the way, Moses did something that God wanted him not to do. God simply told Moses to tell the rock to produce water, but Moses, out of his anger, strikes the rock twice. Water does come out, but God turns to Moses and says, "Moses, because you did not treat me holy and obey me, you will lead your people right to the forefront of the Canaan promised land, but you yourself will not enter it." Now Moses became 120 years old. First 40 years of his life, he grew up as the prince of Egypt. Next 40 years, he became a murderer, and he was fleeing from the king Pharaoh, and he lived as a desert in a Midian desert. The next 40 years, from 80 to 120, he went back to Egypt. He brought 2 million Jews out, wandered around in the desert for 40 years. Finally, when he turned 120, he was looking at the promised land that they were supposed to occupy, but he was going to die without entering. With any transition of leadership, comes a lot of uncertainties and turmoils. Who became the leader of 2 million Jewish people after Moses? His name is none other than Joshua, the son of Nun. You got to understand, Joshua was not his original name. His original name was Hosea, surprisingly. But for whatever reasons, we have no idea what transpired him to be called Joshua, Moses began to call him Joshua. What does the name Joshua mean? It means God is salvation. In Hebrew, Joshua is the equivalent of Jesus Christ. Not the Christ part, but Jesus in Greek. So if you were to call Jesus Christ, Jesus, according to Hebraic language, you actually have to call him Joshua. There was certain significance in naming this man Joshua. He was the salvation from God, symbolically and physically, to take 2 million Jewish people ultimately to the promised land. However, if I was in Joshua's shoes, there would be many concerns of becoming the next leader for the nation of Israel. And because of that, Moses takes Joshua aside and says these words as God inspired him. And according to Joshua chapter 1, which is the next book after Deuteronomy, the same words are repeated. There are three specific commands that Deuteronomy 31 verses 7 and 8 gives to Joshua. So would you open your Bibles and read with me aloud? Let's just focus on those two verses and let's try to figure out what are commands. Verse 7, are you ready? Set, go. Then Moses summoned Joshua and said to him in the presence of all Israel, "Be strong and courageous, for you must go with this people into the land that the Lord swore to your forefathers to give them, and you must divide it among them as their inheritance. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged." Can you find out after reading what the three commands are? And that's today's main framework for the sermon. I believe what Moses instructed Joshua is very pertinent to us this day and age, and I'll describe that. First command is found in verse 7. What is it? Be strong and courageous. Joshua really needed internal fortitude to be strong and to be courageous. Why? Because he was succeeding Moses. It's sort of like this. You are a basketball player in the city of Chicago playing as a bench warmer while Michael Jordan is at his best. You sit at the bench, you look at Jordan fly, you see all the great things he does, and suddenly Jordan retires and you are plugged into that position and you have to do what Michael Jordan used to. Everyone's looking to you. Maybe this is not striking you home. Okay, Kobe Bryant, or Shaq, or whoever it is that you enjoy and love. Moses is the guy who split the ocean apart. He made rocks pump water out. He made manna to fall. Certainly God did it, but God did it through Moses as if it's not enough. He went up to the mountain and fasted for 40 days and 40 nights without eating any food, as well as not drinking any water, not only once, twice. And not only that, when he came down from the mountain, he brought two tablets that contained 10 commandments. How do you equal a guy like that? How do you succeed a leader as great as Moses? Not only that, if you think about this carefully, Joshua started to be the servant of Moses and followed him from the very beginning of Exodus. And I am so assuming at the time when Moses first recruited Joshua and called Hosea to be Joshua and trained him, probably Joshua was a little over 20 years old. I'm just totally speculating because of the circumstance. Since the Exodus, how many years did they wander around before they went to the Canaan Promised Land? How many years? 40 years. Do the math. By the time when Joshua is inheriting the leadership, he is well past 60, if not 70, or if not 75 years old. If you are 30 years old, 40 years old, you're full of vigor, you're full of ambition, you are saying, I could handle it, just give it to me. Moses, I was so waiting for you to retire. You reigned on a little too long, you're 120 years old. But you got to understand, Joshua is at the age when most people do retire. 60, 70. Not only that, all his peer group, other than Caleb, all died. So he's got a whole bunch of young people, and Joshua could have easily said, at least Moses had his older brother Aaron, his older sister Miriam, and her husband Hur, and all these people circled around him, call it nepotism, but their family members gathered to support Moses and led these 2 million people this far. I don't have anybody. I'm all alone. And I am supposed to lead these 2 million disobedient and so often ready to stone their leaders so that we could go back to Egypt people into the promised land. And now what's the challenge ahead? It's the flooding season, so River Jordan that they have to go across is so flooded, it is so wide, water flows so fast, there's no way they could cross over. They can't make boats, they can't make bridges. How do you cross 2 million people with babies and all sorts of things? Once you cross over into the Jordan, one of the first fortified city that they have to attack is the city of Jericho. Many scholars have investigated, it's some 70, 80 feet high, and they didn't build tiny walls like we did. People literally lived in the wall, meaning the wall was so thick, maybe it was thick as 60, 70 feet wide. It is enormous ancient city. That's not everything. The people who lived in that city were at least 2 feet bigger than Big Sam. You understand, Sam? Okay. You think he's big, huh? There are people foot 2 feet too big, bigger than him, occupying the land where Jewish people thought, compared to them, we're like grasshoppers. And they dwell in these mighty cities, and we don't have cannons and guns to shoot. How are we ever going to occupy this land? If I was in the shoes that had to fill what Moses left behind, I would definitely decline. I'd say, Lord, I'm too old. These people are too much of jerks. And what's awaiting for us is way too insurmountable. I can't. I don't want to be the leader for these people. But Joshua had to accept. He was groomed for the past 40 years to be the leader. So knowing all that, Moses, inspired by God, first says, Joshua, be strong and courageous. If you want to rely on your human strength, if you want to rely on your 40 years of experience, if you want to rely on your battle strategies, if you want to rely on the group of counsel that will help you, I know you have reasons to be discouraged and be afraid, but Joshua, be strong and courageous because you depend on God, not on people, not on yourself, but Almighty God is your rock. Be strong and courageous. Maybe because many of you are young, healthy, and prime of your life, you walk around with certain amount of arrogance. You drive with confidence. You talk with some sort of entitlement. And you say, I don't need to be trust in God. I don't need to depend on God. I could handle this. And you live your life thinking you're so strong and so confident and nothing can stand your way. You might be the weakest person in this room. It's not our experiences. It's not the money we have. It's not the connections we hold. It's not how big and strong we are that makes us strong, but it is really how much we depend and trust in God that makes us strong. You know, I enjoy lifting weight because I notice that as I get older, I can't jump as high, I can't run as fast, I can't dribble. I never was able to dribble. And at least I used to shoot 3 points pretty well. Now, nah, it just doesn't happen. So I had to settle for something that doesn't make me move that much. And that was lifting weights. When I picked up lifting weights, I observed certain behaviors in the people that are in the gym. There are always these wimpy people who feel very lacking confidence and who seem to move in and out as if they don't exist. They do their thing and they're out. Then there are always those kids. They would wear wife beater t-shirts, or they carry a huge jug mixed with all sorts of amino acid muscle enhancing drinks. And they're always talking loud, and you know, when they do whatever, it's just a lot of noise. And I see lots of confidence in them because they lift way more than other people, or they're bigger than other people. There's a certain sense of arrogance you could see in their face. There's no way I'm anywhere near what they do. But every time I see a human arrogance because of their beauty, or because of their stature, or because of the type of car they drive or type of position they hold in their company, it is the most sad thing that I could see. Because all they trust is their human strength and ability, none on God. And just as the snap of the finger, one virus can attack that 300-pound, you know, 1,000-pound lifting energetic man, and he could all crumble down sooner than you know. Many of you who are beautiful, you act like you're beautiful, and it's sick. You think that beauty will last forever? Even if you go get weekly Botoxing, you can't keep up. You could do so many facelifts where your belly button's at your neck. It ain't gonna do you any good when the time comes. It's just not that great when you trust in yourself and your confidence is in what you own. That's why God knew that better. And when you study the Bible, it's often people who have lost confidence in themselves God seemed to use. Because when they're so full of themselves, when they think they're smarter than others, stronger than others, they are at their prime, usually they interfere with what God wants to do. God tells them to go this way, but their energy and their experience and their power says, no, God, I got to go this way. This is making sense. Not that way. Just as Moses at age 40, at his prime, educated by the finest educational system in Egypt, he was a prince. He wanted to liberate his people, but he became a simple murderer and had to flee to the desert. But age 80, when he couldn't even talk right, he was humble shepherd in the desert, married to a foreign lady, became nobody. That's when God called him for his service. In all of our lives, God says, be strong and courageous, not because who you are, but because you trust and depend on God. When people are concerned over health, When people are concerned over finance, when people are concerned over marriage, when people are worried about the well-being of church, I feel what you feel. But through all those events, in the past 14 years that I have been at the church ministering to the congregation, I could honestly say I had concerns, but it never shook me. Rather, I learned to take the difficulties that come in our way as the fuel to trust in God, depend on Him, and propel us into the next phase of what God wants us to do. Maybe some of you heard the bad news. You didn't make it to the school you wanted. You didn't get the job you wanted. Maybe that failure should be the greatest motivation for you to trust in God and become the greatest person you can ever be because you trust in God. Amen?
Amen.
Second command, towards the end of verse 7 is, Joshua, you are to go in with these people to the promised land, and then God says, divide the land among them. Divide the land among them. You know what I learned about this? It's all about having purpose. It's all about living your life for the purpose that is greater than yourself. God didn't say, or Moses didn't say to Joshua, go into the land and divide the land for yourself and make sure, since you're the leader, you get the best lot. And make sure your family is taken care of. Make sure your name, and you erect a huge monument and statue for yourself. And after Moses, you're the greatest leader for the nation of Israel. I want you to be remembered forever. Joshua was not driven with self-gratifying motivation and purpose, but he was simply to become a public servant. Take the people in, not for your sake, but for the sake of the people of God. And when you occupy the land, divide it up so God's people will inherit the land that God had promised. As we follow Jesus Christ, if your prayers and your drives and your passion is to accomplish and to seek God only for your benefit, your well-being, your blessing, and your immediate family's growth, you're totally missing the boat. What God wants through Joshua still reverberates in every one of us. You ought to have a purpose in your life, not on yourself, but what you can do to benefit others and to serve other people. Our culture is so full of people that are entitled. Well, this is my right. I deserve this. This is what I should have. And even the slightest irregularity that comes into our lives, it totally disturbs us. We will not accept it to a point where we will say, God, this is not fair. Why do we get that way? Because our only focus is upon ourselves. What am I gonna get out of this situation? I understand sometimes you got to take care of yourself. But when God blesses you, when God pours much upon your life, there's a reason for doing that, so that you would be equipped to use the blessings that you have received to have the purpose of serving the community at large. You know one thing I want in our midst? I wish you would begin paying more attention to other people. Giving other people room, not hounding people. You know, those four or five new gals that came. You know, if all the guys come to you only and gets, you know, very welcoming attitude, avoid them. They have ulterior motive. Maybe sometimes we're afraid of that, and we don't express enough how valuable each other are. If we eat our snack, we eat our kimbap today, which they have. If we have a great worship, if I have a nice parking space, well, what's there to worry about? This is a great church. But you're totally missing the point. It's about being mindful of someone next to you, how you could be Christ to serve them and represent the church and minister to each other and to pay attention to their needs and their deficiencies so they could experience the saving and loving work of Jesus Christ. That's what church is all about. Next week is Christmas. Jesus was born in Bethlehem, and he didn't even have a proper delivery. I was coming to church today, and this guy was making a lot of funny things about how the birth of Jesus was in the delivery room. How would you like to deliver your child in a manger where the cows are lowing, where all these animals are barking? Yet that's how Jesus came. The King of Kings and the Lord of the universe came that way. And when Jesus began his public ministry, you know what Jesus said? The reason that the Son of Man, I have come, is not to be served, but I came so that I may serve and to give my life as a ransom for all of you. When our very God, who came to serve, he basically says the same thing to Joshua right now. Your purpose is to not be self-serving, but to serve your people as a leader when you occupy the land, divide it, and let them have it as inheritance. Being courageous, being confident, being so sure of yourself because of who you are in the Lord is needed, but use it for the right purpose. Don't use it for self-advancement only. Sure, grow, advance, and be great, but always look, how can I use my power, my strength, and my connection to help those who are around us? Lastly, thirdly, verse 8 has the third command. And that command, we'll read this verse together and gather it as we read it. Verse 8, are you ready? Let me find it first. Here we go. Let's begin. The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Here comes the command. What's the command? Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. This sounds very similar to be strong and courageous. If you're strong and courageous, do you never worry and are afraid? Of course not. You could be the strongest and most confident person. And the reason why you're strongest and confident is because you're so afraid. Often the strong people are the most insecure people. And the seeming strength that they exhibit is because of their sign of weakness. Because they're so afraid to admit how weak they are. They're so afraid to admit how frail they are. They're so afraid to admit how insecure they are. They come across so confident, so arrogant, so put together. But deep inside, the fear, that concern, that anxiety looms bigger than you could ever imagine. If you happen to be not, that's great. But Joshua had all the reasons to be afraid and to be discouraged. Leading our church, which has about 700 people in attendance, 650 on each Sunday, starting from little babies to elderly people in their 80s and 90s, as the senior pastor of the church, each Sunday I must have at least a handful of people telling me how church should go. Each week I may get an email or a phone call of things that we need to do and should do. Frankly, I don't mind any of that. But when things don't go right, it's so easy to look at the situation and be discouraged and say, I don't know what's going to happen. And I'm so afraid that we may lose it all. But at times you got to understand,
That's exactly how God wants you to feel. So that you would be on your knees seeking Him instead of being so arrogant, so that you trust in yourself.
There is a reason why Joshua shouldn't be afraid and be discouraged. Although he was leading 2 million insubordinate, arrogant, stiff-necked people, there is a reason why he wasn't to be afraid. Although Jericho was mighty, Hittites, Jebusites, Canaanites, all the people that inhabited the land that they had to overtake were so huge, such a renowned warriors. Each one of them could annihilate 10, 20 Jewish men. Joshua had reason not to be afraid and be discouraged about these people.
Why?
Because of what it says in verse 8. Joshua, I will go before you. I will always be with you. I will never depart you, and I'll never desert you.
God Almighty says, Joshua, I'll prepare your way. I will never leave you, and you're always going to be supported by me. Just remember, I am with you.
I got an iPhone, finally. And sorry, all of you who hate Apple. I absolutely love this phone. I got one for my wife. And my daughters who asked for some of these, I got one for my daughter too. Only one of them wanted it. So that child sitting over there has it. We both got black ones, and they're perfect. She wanted feminine one, got a white one. Now, white one's cool, but as soon as she got her iPhone and began using it, she said there are problems. Like when she texts, she says her friends don't sometimes even get it, or she sends it in the morning and they get it in the evening. Something was glitchy, and then it wouldn't pick up Wi-Fi in the house, which I have set up such a nice system. So we had to go to the store and exchange it before 14-day runs out or a week or month runs out. But this is what my daughter does, who seems so confident and she knows swimming the jock attitude everywhere. Dad, can you go with me? Of course. Let's go. And I know the guy who works there. He's been there 5-6 years and I bought my phone number of years from him. I know him by his first name. I even know his nationality. What up, Lawrence? Man, you gave me a bad phone. He didn't even bother looking at my daughter's phone to argue anything. He goes to the back, pulls out a brand new box, unrips it, rips it up, and just reprograms it and gives it to my daughter. And I'm coming out and I'm telling my daughter, it's not what you know, but sometimes it's who you know and how you know that makes all the difference. Because I had befriended this guy. Used to my daughter as an example for 2 weeks in a row, I feel bad. Maybe not really. But when she's having great time with her friends, I'm never needed. But when she's in trouble, when she needs her phone changed, Dad, all of a sudden, is so dear to her. Her phone has problem again. On and off button doesn't click. She came up yesterday, said how wonderful the college group party was, but her real point was, Dad, can you go again to change the phone? And I'll be glad to do that. Why? Because I love my child, right? This is what God says. I will go before you to prepare those cities so that you could take over the land. I'll always be with you
So when these 2 million people are being a jerk again, don't be afraid. I'll never desert you. I'll never leave you. And you are like the apple of my eyes. So don't be afraid. Don't be discouraged. I'm with you. That's what God says.
As you end year 2011 and look forward to year 2012, maybe there are a lot of trepidations, concerns, uncertainties. Your career, you just got a pink slip from the school you work for. Maybe your company is restructuring and you might be the first one to go. Your school is so impacted with every student that they have taken in. There's no room for you to take classes. It just goes on and on. And you find some pain in your belly and something hard is feeling felt and you're just concerned. Very understandable. And it's those times when you feel afraid and when you are discouraged, precisely that's when you turn to God and overcome your trials by trusting in Almighty God that loves you. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray.